Good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's reading assembly. Today I'm in my house. I've tried to do most things from school, but it's not always possible. We haven't had a reading assembly for a couple of weeks. The good news is, although I'm in my house, I have a copy of the book and I have the story circle. Okay, we're going to have a quick recap on where we got to with the old curiosity shop, and then we're going to read the next few pages. You can read along with me, or you can just follow the story. We're going to try something a bit different today, over to Zoom, which is now most people's best friend.
Hey, I'm up here. This is incredible. Right, let's start off with a bit of an update on where we got up to. Thinking about our author, first of all. Charles Dickens. There he is. He lived in Victorian times, which look like they're really close to 2020 now, but it's a couple of hundred years ago. Before we begin, couple of minutes, can you think about what we know about him as a man and what we know about him as an author? You can pause the video or we can just crack straight on. Okay, so do they give you any more clues to try and get that information from your long-term memory back into your working memory? So we know that he was born in 1812, lived in Victorian times and read loads as a child. He had a pet raven called Grip, and he had 10 children, and he gave them peculiar nicknames. What do we know about him as an author? He wrote and slept facing north. His stories had themes, so poverty was a theme, rich and poor was a theme, and he had some fantastic characters in his stories. That was one of the most appealing things about his books. And then we know that he wrote many, many famous books. Oliver Twist, Great Expectations, Christmas Carol, David Copperfield, and the old Curiosity Shop that we're going to carry on now. Talking of that, talking of those books, we are on our fifth abridged Charles Dickens book. Now, remember, abridged means a shortened version. I really like these Real Reads books, because they use a lot of Dickens' original language. And although they take some parts out of the book, some characters are missing and some events are missing, they keep the most exciting bits in. So we've currently had Oliver Twist, Great Expectations, Christmas Carol, David Copperfield, and we're now on the old Curiosity Shop. And in that story so far, we've met Grandfather and we've met Nell over on the left-hand side here. We've also met their friend Kit, cheeky young man. We know that Grandfather is not well. He's very tired. He's getting very weary and he leaves the house every night. We then found out last week that he is a gambler. He's a gamer. He spends lots of money trying to win money, maybe through playing cards or playing other games. And he keeps borrowing money off this man here. Oh. I've gone too far ahead. He keeps borrowing money off of Quilp, Mr. Quilp, who is a really nasty, mean character. Now, nobody knows about Grandfather's secret about his gambling, apart from Quilp eventually, because Quilp finds out. And if we look at this picture over here on the right-hand side, Quilp finds out that Grandfather's been gambling and gaming, and Nell, who is a beautiful, polite young lady, goes to meet Mrs. Quilp, who wants to help her, but we then find out that Mr. Quilp and Mrs. Quilp aren't particularly well suited to each other. And then back over here on the left-hand side, we know that Grandfather is becoming more and more unwell and worried about having lost all of his money. And the story finished last week, a couple of weeks ago. It finished with Mr. Quilp and his lawyer friend, who I believe is Mr. Brass. Yep, Mr. Brass, and they basically came to the old curiosity shop and said, it belongs to us now. And the story finished just as Mr. Quilp told the grandfather that he'd found out that he was a gambler, that he'd lost his money, because Kit told him. And we know that's not true. Kit didn't tell them. Quilp is causing trouble. Also, because I think Quilp has fallen in love with Nell. Okay, let's move on. This is the first event after they've taken, they said the shop is theirs. Having established his tenancy of the shop, and that's a really complicated way of saying now Mr. Quilp owns a shop. He refused to leave his newly acquired property. Day after day, piece by piece, Nell watched as he sold off the old man's collection of curiosities until the building was an empty shell. Every day, he threatened to wring the neck of Nell's little caged linnet, the little bird, which still sang cheerfully in her room. What would happen to the bird, to Nell, and to her grandfather when Quilp decided it was time for them all to go? If people knew about her grandfather's confused mind, they might decide to lock him in a madhouse. Nell knew what they had to do. One night, she crept quietly into her grandfather's room. She woke him gently. Grandfather, grandfather, I'm afraid to stay here any longer. I'm afraid you'll be taken from me. The old man seized his granddaughter's hand as Nell whispered her plan. Let's escape from this sad place. If we are poor, then let's be poor together. Let's walk through the countryside and sleep in fields and never enter dark rooms again.
But we have no money. We'll be beggars.
Then let us at least be happy beggars. As he warmed to Nell's plan, the old man's confused mind failed to foresee the cold, hunger and suffering that might be ahead. Instead, he saw streams and meadows and endless summer days. So it's important to know here, this isn't in the story, it's important to know that Nell's plan is for them to escape, but she's not quite old and mature enough to work out what that will look like. Grandfather is, unfortunately, his mind is not as strong as it was, and he's very forgetful, and he's not able to tell her it's not a good plan. Quietly, Nell began to prepare their few belongings. They would steal away the next night and move away. First, however, Nell needed to tell Kit.
But Nell, why don't you come and live with my family? Said Kit as she wept in front of him. We can't, Kit.
Nell shook her head sadly.
Grandfather says that you are the cause of our misery. He screams and cries that he never wants to see you again. Oh, Kit, what have you done?
Poor Kit was stunned.
I haven't done anything now. You must tell him that. I can't even mention your name in front of him.
She paused and Kit noticed that she was carrying her precious bird in its little cage. She held it out to him and it started to sing.
Quilp, Quilp wants to wring his neck.
That means kill the bird.
Will you take care of him, Kit?
Kit watched in dismay as Nell disappeared into the street. Her bird carried on singing. It would have wrung your heart to see Nell and her grandfather escaping hand in hand through the poverty and the suffering of London's straggling neighbourhoods. But little by little, day by day, the city's grey was replaced by green fields, just like in the picture down here. So it wasn't as bad as what it could have been. There was a positive side here. Green fields, squalid, dirty buildings were replaced by freshly painted little cottages. Now the evenings blessed them with 1,000 beautiful smells as Nell knelt by pools of clear water to wash the city's deep layers of grime from her grandfather's face.
bees hummed their drowsy satisfaction as she soothed her grandfather to sleep. And here they are in this picture, camping out, sleeping out in the countryside. As the nights grew cooler, Nell used the small amount of money they had to find pleasant, simple village lodging. So they managed to find places to sleep. It was very straightforward, very simple. One afternoon, the old man's attention was drawn to a Punch and Judy show on a village green. Now, if you're in year three, four, you might remember Punch and Judy. Maybe even year two, you might remember the Punch and Judy shows that we used to have in year one when you did your seaside learning. So this is actually in Charles Dickens' story. One afternoon, the old man's attention was drawn to a Punch and Judy show on a village green. Nell's heart ached to see her grandfather's childlike enjoyment. He loved sitting and watching. But her mind was also troubled. Their money was almost gone, run out. They would soon have to start begging and asking people for help. That evening, Nell had an opportunity to discuss their problem with the men who ran the show. And she was delighted when they suggested that they all travel together. There were races in a nearby town, and it would be a good place to beg. The next night, Nell overheard a conversation between their new companions.
So who are this man and girl then, Smart?
Asked Mr. Codlin quietly.
They're clearly new to begging, and the old man ain't in the right mind, is he?
His friend snorted.
If you ask me, they've run away.
He mused for a moment, then a smile crossed his face.
They'll be missed, especially the girl. It's quite possible there'll be a reward for their return.
Codlin looked suspiciously at Smart.
If there should be a reward, Smart, remember that we're partners in everything.
Nell returned sadly to their lodgings. There was a lot they needed to do at the races tomorrow, learn how to beg and find a way of escaping the clutches of their false friends. Right, so let's just pause for a moment. They've had a really sad start to this story. They've lost a shop. They've moved to the countryside and they're feeling a bit more positive. And now they've met a group of people that are probably going to try and trick them. I'm going to try and get a reward for them because these new friends, Codlin and Smart, think that they've run away and maybe there's a reward to find them. It's a classic Charles Dickens story. It goes up and down, up and down. Our emotions are dragged all over the place. The town, when they got there, was filled with entertainers, freaks and drunkards. Talk to your families about that. Among whom little Nell led her grandfather. When she approached richly dressed ladies and gentlemen to sell them flowers from her basket, the ladies smiled gently to see such a pretty face, not noticing how tired and hungry that pretty face looked. Codlin and Smart, having found a convenient spot to pitch their show, were soon busy entertaining a considerable crowd. Nell saw that this was the moment to escape. Right, we're going to finish there for today. If your family have listened to this with you, or if your family know the story, have a bit of a chat with them about where we're at. We've got Nell and the grandfather on the run away from Quilp and the curiosity shop. They've got nowhere to go. They've left Kit back in the shop. Living with his family, but close to the shop, looking after the little bird. And now we've got Codlin and Smart, another two bad guys that are looking to trick grandfather and Nell, and Nell is just about to escape with her grandfather. I don't know where they're going. I don't know what they're going to do. What I do know is that some of these names are going to come back to us. See you next week.
Right, couple of quick shout outs before I finish. First of all, happy birthday, year five Ruby. Have a great day today. And also, well done, Joey, in year two for your fantastic hospital Lego model. I'm going to put that out on the Twitter this afternoon. Right, have a good day, everyone. I'll see you for tomorrow's singing assembly, and I might be back in here. See you then.